As usual with these videos, I like to start with a question. Today I've been wondering about our place in history and want to ask, if you could live in any time period, what time period and why? Perhaps you'd like to go back to ancient Greece, the birthplace of democracy and the start of Western philosophy. Or maybe you'd like to drink wine with the Romans, paint during the Renaissance, dance in the 1920s, enjoy the innocence of the 50s, the excitement of the 80s, or simply, you are happy to live here and now. The fact of the matter is, throughout human history, there is one universal inevitability that must be faced, the passing of time, or in other words, change. It is this inevitability that we must learn to understand in order to appreciate what was, what is, and what could be. Looking at our current climate in the first half of the 21st century, rapid changes have been apparent in all walks of life, from politics to technology to societal values. And during this period of great change, there have been many reactions, that of hope, faith, and optimism, and that of fear and caution. But with regards to culture, and specifically film, one feeling I've noticed really stand out in recent years is a sense of nostalgia. Nostalgia can be defined as a sentimentality for the past, which psychologist Neil Burtman notes is more pronounced in times of transition. We can have personal nostalgia for moments in our own past, or historical nostalgia, a more abstract version of the past based on stories and representation we have seen in art and the history books. Either way, research shows nostalgia can provide reassurance and comfort, that engaging in nostalgic activities can be an effective coping mechanism to deal with an uncomfortable present. But equally, it must be handled carefully. The Romans recognized this long ago with the phrase, "The past is always well remembered," something psychologists later called rosy retrospection, a cognitive bias that suggests we can sometimes judge the past more positively than we judge the present. So is nostalgia a form of self-deception that involves distortion or idealization of the past? Or is there something fundamentally lacking in our society and culture today? Well, Woody Allen's Midnight in Paris captures this idea very well, exploring the psychology of nostalgia and the notion of the golden age fallacy, summarized in this scene.
You know, nostalgia is denial. Denial of the painful present.
Oh, well, Gil is a complete romantic. I mean, he would be more than happy living in a complete state of perpetual denial.
Really?
And the name for this fallacy is called golden age thinking.
Ah, touche.
Yeah, the erroneous notion that a different time period is better than the one one's living in. You know, it's a flaw in the romantic imagination of those people who find it difficult to cope with the present. Mm. Mm.
Despite knowing this, our protagonist Gil finds himself in the 20s and expectedly falls in love with the sensibilities and the environment. However, importantly, the film concludes with Gil finally understanding the golden age fallacy when Marion Cotillard's character, Adriana, reveals her longing for the past.
Surely you don't think the 20s are a golden age?
Well, yeah, to me they are.
But I'm from the 20s and I'm telling you the golden age is la belle époque.
I mean, and look at these guys. I mean, to them, their golden age was the Renaissance. You know, they'd trade Belle Epoque to be painting alongside Titian and Michelangelo. And those guys probably imagine life was a lot better when Kublai Khan was around. I'm having an insight now. It's a minor one.
In this way, Allen describes nostalgia as a universal flaw that must be understood in order to accept and appreciate the present moment. Moving on, not only have we noticed nostalgia in the stories we tell, but also in the way we tell them. Nostalgic filmmaking. In his thesis on nostalgia, PhD student Matthew Cooper suggests that the recent disruptions posed by streaming, the destabilization of the DVD market, waning cinema attendance, and the technological shift from celluloid to digital have all influenced nostalgic filmmaking. Just look at the digital versus celluloid debate. Digital cameras came about in the 90s to provide a like-for-like alternative to celluloid. And in 2012, less than 16 years later, digital finally overtook film, becoming the more popular method to shoot movies. And now, as of 2017, 92% of films are shot on digital. While there is a clear dominance of digital cameras in the last decade, there are some prominent filmmakers holding on to film and preserving their passion for the analog process. Nostalgic filmmaking, therefore, has risen in recent years amongst the top directors as a response to preserve previous technology and tradition in the face of industrial change. But why? Well, one argument may include that digital is not a like-for-like comparison to analog film. As filmmaker M. Night Shyamalan explains, digital is just too smooth. You have to degrade the image to make it more real. Digital will be smoother, crisper, perfect in every way, and film will be grainy. You'll definitely grab my picture over the digital one. Understanding that there is a difference between film and digital will help explain why more war films are shot on celluloid and more sci-fi films are shot on digital. The difference helps emphasize the genre. As a counterpoint to nostalgic filmmaking, cinematographers like Roger Deakins believe this.
I'd use an iPhone, I wouldn't. I'm fed up with this conversation. I think it's what's in the frame. And
it always is, isn't it?
How you light it. The first film I did digitally was In Time.
Right.
And we made the decision to shoot that digitally because of the kind of film it was. We wanted something a bit. Actually, we wanted it a bit synthetic, but we were only going to use it for part of the film.
Right.
And then we just thought, well, it's not. I don't see any difference. And I just thought at that point, you know, the time had come to start shooting digitally.
Yeah.
And
that's how I felt too.
Yeah.
Now, taking into account both nostalgia films and nostalgic filmmaking, I want to ask the question, what are we nostalgic for exactly? Looking at the film La La Land, I think we're nostalgic for tangibility. Tangibility is material and substantial. It is reality and physical. We can quantify tangibility. Damien Chazelle knows this and juxtaposes between modern and old designs in an attempt to provide some continuity with the past. We open with the 1950s lens series CinemaScope as we hear car horns in the background. Character Sebastian drives a 1982 Buck Riviera convertible while Mir drives a modern Prius. Sebastian is obsessed with analog, vinyl, old photos and memorabilia, while Mir, who is equally interested in history, updates her design to fit a modern house. Just look at her Ingrid Bergman poster in her room. The film utilizes old aesthetic styles with vignettes in the corner of the screen, fade-ins and fade-outs, and old-style title cards. Ultimately, what I think this shows is that we are in a mood for continuity. We live in a time where there is talk of a metaverse, virtual reality, NFTs, and artificial intelligence. I think there's nothing wrong with a bit of nostalgia for the analog in the face of digital revolution. This is why we love to see practical effects, knowing that there is a physical reality to the action. This is why filmmakers love shooting on film, choosing the physical imperfection rather than the perfect digital. Professor Svetlana Boyum suggests that nostalgia acts as a counterpoint to our fascination with cyberspace and the virtual global village, an effective yearning for a community with a collective memory, a defense mechanism in a time of accelerated rhythms of life and historical upheavals. Boyum distinguishes that there are two types of nostalgia, restorative and reflective. Restorative is our rosy retrospection, our human bias, acting as a conspiracy that makes the past seductive and manipulative. While reflective nostalgia is aware of our place in history, it does not shy away from modernity, as it is not about the past, but rather about universal values. Values such as family, truth, respect, and freedom. Bringing me back to my question, if you could live in any time period, what time period and why? Well, to be honest, the question's irrelevant. What's important is that we embrace the here and now, recognizing our place in history. That when we look backward, we don't look back with rosy retrospection at a myth, but objectively recognizing universal values, those values that we should maintain and preserve with the passing of time. So as we move forward in this ever-growing digital age, we should use nostalgia as our rearview mirror, one that reminds us of where we've come from, as we look for those principles that will help guide us into the future.